إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن نبينا وحبيبنا محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم. نشهد بأنه عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، نشهد بأنه قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وجعلها على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد، all praises are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We bear witness that there is no deity or divinity worthy of worship but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And we bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, may Allah's peace and blessings be upon him, his family, his companions, and all his followers. We bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is indeed the last messenger and prophet sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to all mankind. Sent with the message of peace, of justice, of brotherhood, of equality, of mercy. Indeed, that is the message of Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala account us among the followers of Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam in this dunya, and may he raise us on the day of judgment in his presence, in his company, in the Firdaus al-A'la. Ameen. My dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this Jum'ah a blessed Jum'ah to all of us and for our ummah worldwide, especially those who are suffering in many other places. Ameen. Today I would like to discuss a concept that is common to us that sometimes we take for granted as a community, as a Muslim community. Concept that links two important principles for us, and that is love and sacrifice. The concept of loving something, someone, and be willing and ready to sacrifice for it. Sacrifice is when you're willing to give up something dear to you in the hope or for something that is dearer than what you're giving up. That's what sacrifice is. You sacrifice your time for a good cause. You sacrifice your time as a student in the hope you will get knowledge, ilm, education. You sacrifice that in order to get a job so you can sustain and take care of yourself, your family, your community. You sacrifice some of your money for the poor in the reward that you get the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You sacrifice some of your time from business to pray because you want to seek Allah's pleasure in obeying His orders and getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we all know what sacrifice means. And the dearer the thing to you, the more willing you are to sacrifice. You love your children, you love your spouse, you love your parents. May Allah give them good health for you and keep them, inshallah, healthy and alive around you. But if, may Allah forbids, your son or your daughter or your mother comes to you and says, I just came back from the doctor and the doctor said, my kidney is failing. I need another kidney to survive. You would not hesitate for a second to say, I'm here, you can take one of my kidneys. Because you love. And the more you love, the more you're willing to give with pleasure. You don't feel it as a sacrifice in that sense. How about if the thing you love is Islam? Something that is the dearest to you and something that has changed your life and will continue to change your life until the hereafter. Something that is the most important thing to you in your life, Islam. How willing are you or me going to be to sacrifice for that? How much of our time, our mind, our thinking, our money, our resources, even our lives. So when we think, it's important to put that in perspective. That we as Muslims know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with this iman, with this Islam. Chose us. We didn't really, many of us did little effort. It's a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That blessing comes with it, brings with it tests. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Holy Quran when he says in Surah Al-Ankabut, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم أحسب الناس أن يتركوا أن يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون ولقد فتنا الذين من قبلهم فليعلمن الله الذين صدقوا وليعلمن الكاذبين. الله سبحانه وتعالى tells us in the Quran, did people think that they will be allowed or left to say we believe without being tested? Did they really believe that they will be allowed to say we believe without getting tested, without being put to the test? Allah answers this rhetorical question by saying, we have tested people before them. We have tested people before them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can make it clear who are the ones that are truthful and who are the ones that are false, that are untruthful. Who are the ones who are sadaqu, who did sadq with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with their claim? And who are the kadhibin, the one who make false claims? Meaning, Allah knows, by the way, already. Allah knows what is in our heart. So it's not the knowledge for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First of all, it is a knowledge for us. Because sometimes we don't know how fake we are. You know, if we go into a stadium and we ask people, how many of you are believers who want to go to Jannah? And we have 5,000 people, and we ask that question, you know how many people will raise their hands? 5,000 people. We are believers, we want to go to Jannah. You ask them, okay, how many of you are believers want to go to Jannah and are willing to donate some money for this project? You know, fewer hands would raise. How many of you are willing to sacrifice more? Fewer and fewer. May Allah make us among the truthful ones. Allah is saying, I will show you whether you really meant it or you were just saying it. Because it's a habit, it's a culture, it's peer pressure. Because Allah does not want you on the day of judgment when Allah says, imagine if Allah said, without testing us, imagine if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, those of you on this side will go to Jannah, this group will go to hellfire. And this group will say, why Allah? Say, because I knew already you are not truthful. You know what our answer would be? Oh Allah, why didn't you test us? If you had tested us, maybe we would have done differently. Allah knows, it would not have changed. But Allah gives us the test. So that's another reason for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us, when it comes to tests, when it comes to willing to sacrifice, to be willing to sacrifice. The Prophet ﷺ said, it's not going to be easy. Especially at the latter times, the later days. He said, يأتي زمان على الناس الصابر فيه على دينه كالقابض على الجمر. There will come a time for people, and we might be living in that time. He said, there will come a time for people where the ones who hold steadfast unto the religion, unto their iman, the requirements of the religion, is like the one holding a burning charcoal. You know how you feel the heat? Imagine, don't do it, just imagine holding a burning charcoal. Do not try that at home. Imagine if you're holding it, how many seconds can you take? 1 second, 2 seconds? Most of us will say, I can't take it anymore. There will come a time when holding to this religion, saying, I am a Muslim, I need to pray, I have the right to wear hijab, I have the right to grow a beard, I have the right to build a masjid in New York, in Lower Manhattan, in Garden Grove, in Temecula, or anywhere else. Saying, I'm a Muslim who believes in Allah, I'm a Muslim who believes in Sharia, I am a Muslim who believes in all the teachings of the Prophet. There will come a time when it be a lot of heat to say that. How many of us are going to give up that charcoal, that burning charcoal, and say, let's compromise. Let's compromise, you know, maybe we don't need the masjid after all. Maybe the prayers can be delayed at the end of the day. Maybe the hijab is not a necessity anymore, it's a cultural thing. Maybe and maybe and maybe. Maybe the sharia is something bad. Maybe the Quran was meant only for the early times. Many of us, when the heat comes, sometimes we're willing to sacrifice the religion. Rather than, because that's what the misunderstanding of sacrifice, rather than sacrificing for the religion. We misunderstood sacrifice. Instead of being willing to pay a price, yes, stand up for your rights and say, yes, I'm a Muslim. You know, you're at the workplace and you say, I need to take time off to pray Jum'ah. Your boss says, hey, listen, this is a workplace, you leave your religion at home. You do whatever you want to do at the weekend. All right, you know what, alhamdulillah, at least Allah, you know, I tried. You retreat at the first hurdle, you give up. A sister goes and applies for the job and they tell her, well, you know what? We don't allow that thing on your head here. You know, here, we're a secular company. You want to work at your mosque or your church, do it. But here, everybody, you see, everybody doesn't have that on their hair. Well, because everybody is not required to do it. Now imagine that sister who goes and says, well, you know what? At least I tried. What can I do? And some people do that. And I'm not belittling people. But I'm looking at the bigger picture. If we keep on retreating and retreating and compromising on the principles and the foundation of the religion, then what we are leaving the religion with? What are we leaving? What? How much of the religion are we leaving for our children? Imagine if I and you give up our right to be treated with respect at the airport, or at the border, or in our mosques, or at the workplace, or at the schools for our children. And we say, you know what can we do? We're foreigners. We are second-class citizens. We're a minority. Because these are the things I hear from Muslims sometimes. We believe we are second-class citizens, at least some of us. And we're willing to take anything. So, alhamdulillah, at least they allow us to have a job. Alhamdulillah, we can eat and drink. You know, if I were in that country, you know, XYZ country, they would have done worse things. You know, you don't live in another country. You live in this country. And you have the same rights and responsibilities that everybody else has. If we continue to retreat and retreat on the principles, we'll wake up one day, we're leaving nothing for our children. I tell you from what I hear from companies, many companies one day, when we go to them through the care office, defending the right of a person, a Muslim person, brother or sister, to practice their religion, a prayer, wear hijab, go to Jum'ah, pray 5 times a day. You know the number one answer we hear from companies. The number one answer we hear is, why is XYZ asking for that right? We have 20 other Muslims who worked for us for the last 10 years. Never, no one ever asked for that. Or when they asked, we told them you can't do it. They said, all right,